going to talk to you.
Thank you.
As we sing this morning through the songs, I pray that you allow them to be your declaration this morning. Maybe your cry as you reach out to our Father in heaven, as we celebrate the triumphal entry of Christ in Jerusalem, as you think of the image of the crowds, the throngs of people welcoming Jesus Christ, the Son of God, Jerusalem, the holy city. Think of your own life. Many of us here this morning, we feel crowded by our worries, anxieties, and fears. We feel crowded by our own challenges, maybe the doctor's report, or maybe whatever you're working through. And you're thinking, I'm in church this morning. I'm in the house of God. I'm here to worship, and I have such a hard time worshiping. As we sing Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel, Jesus Christ, the Anointed One, the Son of God. And maybe can I encourage you, as we make space in your thought life right now, in your heart, in your feelings, for what if, for a moment, you just turn your eyes upon Jesus, his triumphal entry in Jerusalem. And this morning, allow him to triumphantly enter your life with his promises, with his purpose, with his plan, with his peace. I'm reminded of the image of the story of the woman with the issue of blood who countless of years could not be healed. And she heard the news that Jesus is in town. And Jesus is surrounded by crowds of people. She knew one thing. I hope that you know this thing too. All it takes, an act of desperation. As the woman thought in her heart, if only I touch the hem of his garment. Jesus doesn't need to speak to me. I just need to touch him. And as she does, she pushes through the crowds, and she reaches out and touches Jesus right there and then. Jesus says, a power left his body. He asks his disciples, who touched me? And they're in bewilderment. They say, Master, who touched you? Look at the throngs of people around you. No, but Jesus knew one thing, that somebody touched him in faith. And I pray just like that woman with the issue of blood in the Bible. You live this morning having touched the hem of his garment. As you raise a hallelujah, a highest praise to Jesus for what he has done in our life. As we welcome him, as we celebrate what is possible with God. So as we make room, as we sing the song, as we lift our highest praise, let him enter your relationships, your marriage, your finances, your professional life, all of your circumstances, and say, Jesus, we are here for you. We make room. Enter in with your solution, with your report, with your ways, with your purpose. Surrender to him. Bow before him. And watch him do that which only he can do. As we lift our highest praise to him for his word. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Christ Alive. It is my honor and pleasure to be here this morning to bring you announcements today. I welcome everyone who's here for the first time, as well as those who are here every Sunday and those watching online. On behalf of Pastor Christy, welcome to Christ Alive on this beautiful Palm Sunday after yet another rainy Saturday. We appreciate you guys being here today. We have a great message in store for you this morning. If this is your first time here with us, we invite you to fill out a connection card, which can be found in the seat back in front of you. Complete that card, and you can leave it in the black box on the in the back of the church on your way out. Additionally, there are donation envelopes, which can also be left in the black box at the back of the church. If you're watching online or you'd like to donate online, you can visit us at Christ Alive NY. We have a few announcements this morning. We would like to announce our life groups, which are small group Bible studies. The first is going to be happening this Thursday, April 4th at 7 p.m. And that's going to be in my home in North Belmore. And it's God Never Gives Up on You. And that's in person with me. Those will be 7 p.m. on Thursdays. We invite you to sign up. You can find the sign up for all the life groups at Christ Alive NY. And in addition, you can go to the Church Center app for that. Next, we have Fridays at 7 p.m., and the first one will be on April 5th with John Gazinski at on Zoom, and that will be the Sermon on the Mount, so please feel free to sign up for that one. In addition to that, we have the Christ Alive Sisterhood, which is a women's ministry, which will be starting on April 6th at 10 a.m. You should see some imagery on the screens in front of you with the information for that. We welcome you to participate in that. That will be a once-a-month Bible study that will be starting again on April 6th at 10 a.m. Next, we have the Christ Alive Brotherhood, which is the men's ministry. That's going to be on Saturday, April 13th at 10:30 a.m. I invite all the children here to go downstairs for Bible study at this point for Sunday school. So you're invited to bring the kids down. And lastly, I'd like to announce our Good Friday service, which is going on this Friday at 7 p.m. here at the church. So please come out and join us for a wonderful Good Friday service. So again, welcome to Christ Alive. Welcome Pastor Bob up for our Palm Sunday message, which is dealing with doubts.
Yep, that should be it. Happy Palm Sunday. Hooray. So today, of course, is the day that the church around the world is celebrating what's often called the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. Let's stand up, and I want to read the scripture, the story from the Gospel of John. It's in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And in John chapter 12, verses 12 through 16, it says, "When the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him and began shouting, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, indeed the King of Israel.'" And by the way, this was to fulfill Psalm 118, verses 25 and 26. "These things his disciples did not understand at first." And just briefly, it's not a major part of the message, but there are three groups that we see here. The first are the disciples who, I thought Christy was waving at me. The first of the disciples who didn't understand what was going on. And then we read the people, that's the second group, went to meet him. And this was the crowd we mentioned, read about a few minutes ago, who brought out their palm branches and shouted, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, indeed, the King of Israel." But here's the reason they were doing that. It says, because they heard that he had performed this sign. And the context there is that Jesus had raised his friend Lazarus from the dead only a few days earlier. Lazarus lived in a town called Bethany, which is about 2 miles from Jerusalem. So it spread throughout Jerusalem. Everybody was there. The crowd, they were craning their neck primarily to see this man who had raised Lazarus from the dead. And the same people, by the way, who were shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna," on Sunday were the ones who cried out, "Crucify him," on Friday. And instead of saying, "Indeed, he is the King of Israel," they were saying, "We have no king but Caesar."
And then finally, the third group is the Pharisees said to one another, see that you're not accomplishing anything. Look, the world has gone after him. The day they found out that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead was the day the Sanhedrin got together and decided Jesus had to die. So a few days earlier, they had issued sort of a death warrant on Jesus. Let's pray. Father, I ask you to bless this word. Speak your power, your life, and your truth, God, your life-changing truth by your words in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay. So what I want to look at today is something that is very often and very easily missed when it comes to Palm Sunday. Let me suggest that the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem wasn't all that triumphant, really. Right? The disciples were clueless, the people were fickle, and the Pharisees wanted to kill him. And in varying degrees, they all doubted Jesus. So I think it's fair to say that when you and I experience doubts, we're in mixed company, if not in good company, okay? And you also have to be aware, because I am going to be talking about doubt today, that doubting in the spiritual realm is a huge spectrum. On one end, I pray that there are people here and people online who are wondering if God even exists. And at the other end, there are people who are been around for a long time, have known the Lord and walk with the Lord, but sometimes you start going through real struggles and you don't doubt his existence, you don't doubt his love. But it's sort of sometimes easy to really doubt, Lord, do you really have this? it's hard for me to really grasp. And so today what I want to look at, as Michelle said, dealing with doubts, and I want to look at the Gospel of John primarily, this story and other stories from John, and some personal wrestlings that I've been going through. So let me start by giving you sort of a thumbnail sketch of Jesus' ministry. For 3 years, he went throughout Israel doing good, healing the sick, raising the dead, the blind saw, the lame walked, the deaf heard. He taught and he preached, and for 3 years, he blessed the people. And then on Palm Sunday, he entered into Jerusalem. The crowds were adoring him, laying down their cloaks and their palm branches and so on. 4 days later was Maundy Thursday, the Last Supper. A Passover Seder where Judas betrayed him. He goes into the Garden of Gethsemane, and he's sweating drops of blood, and he's praying, God, take this cup from my hand, but not thy will, my will, but thy will be done. And then, of course, on the next day, he was crucified. Then the Bible says 3 days later, he rose from the dead. Do you ever wonder about that? I think there's a mistake in the Bible. I mean, think about it. From Friday night to Saturday night is one day, to Sunday morning is a day and a half. All over the place. And multiple times in the Bible it says Jesus rose again on the third day. Well, you know what the problem is? We're American. We think that everything's about us. It doesn't work that way. This is just the way they counted days back in Jesus' day. It's, I don't know, tradition, the language, whatever. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 3 days. That's how it was. Pretty straightforward. Anyway, he rises from the dead on the third day. He walked throughout the earth for 40 days, and multitudes saw him, probably over 1,000 people. We know that 500 saw him at one point in time. And then right before he ascended, he walked the earth for 40 days. He was about to ascend. He called the disciples to himself. He gave them direction. He said, all authority has been granted to me in heaven and earth, and now I'm giving you authority. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. So I want to read part of the story of that ascension. That version is in the book of Acts. Here's how it went down in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 16 and 17. The 11 disciples, and that would be the 12 minus Judas, proceeded to Galilee. to the mountain which Jesus had designated to them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him. But some were doubtful. I mean, how is that even possible? But you know, have you ever noticed that sometimes when bad things happen to other people, it sort of encourages us? I'm encouraged by what I just read in Matthew 28. I mean, these guys must have been so pumped. They must have been so committed. They've been through everything with Jesus. And now here they are with the resurrected Christ looking right at them, and some of them are doubting. You see, that encourages me because I doubt. I'll be honest with you, okay? I don't know if that makes me a bad person or not, but it's true. And I'll tell you, along those lines of my sort of personal iniquities, I want to add another one, and it's about doubt. It's about something that I've said on a multitude of occasions, sometimes from the pulpit, sometimes in conversation, but you might have heard me say, if you don't feel close to God, who moved? Well, I'll tell you, after a lot of thought and experience, the answer just often is simply neither of you. Eugene Peterson is a very famous Christian. He wrote a book. It's still in print. It's still a bestseller 44 years later. It was published in 1980. You can still get it on Amazon or whatnot. And the title of it is a description of what the book is about. It's about discipleship. The title is A Long Obedience in the Same Direction. And in many ways, that's what our faith is all about. Basically, the story of discipleship is putting one foot in front of the other and just walking and walking and going forward. But it doesn't always happen. It's not always sort of a straight line. Sometimes you got to zig and sometimes you got to zag and sometimes you got to go one way. Sometimes you even go backwards. Listen, let me tell you three quick, quick stories that brought me to where I am today. The very first time that I recall, the very first setback in my faith, I was very young in the Lord. I became a Christian in December, and there was something called the match in medical school. I think it was March. Is it March, Scott? Okay, yes. You know, he's a couple of decades closer. So I was 3 or 4 months old in the Lord, I guess, like, you know, 3 days, depends on how you count. That was sort of a joke. Anyway, the way it works briefly is that medical students go and they interview in multiple different programs, and then the programs interview multiple medical students, and then on a designated day, everybody submits their choices, and the computer puts it all together, and everybody gets an envelope. This on match day, this is where you're going. So in my case, I'm sure each school does it differently, but the way they did it was the dean of the school, we all got together, had a little refreshments, I don't remember the specifics, but he had a box of envelopes in alphabetical order. So I'm C, Canter, toward the front of the list, and I became very close with about a half a dozen Christian medical students at the Christian Medical Society. One of the people was Irene Warner, W. So I got my envelope way in front of her, and we were both talking and so on and so forth. I got my envelope, I opened it up, and it was my last choice. And I was devastated. I remember looking at Irene, and we had spoken about where we hoped to go and so on. And I just said, I got my last choice. And I wasn't doing this. I was like taking a couple of steps backwards. But you know, God knows what we're able to deal with. And back then, I was able to deal with maybe 15 or so minutes of this. Because I remember Irene just got this beatific look on her face and just looked at me and said, well, praise the Lord. And all of a sudden, the burden just lifted, and I said, I know God is in control. And I matched at Nassau Medical Center. The only reason I ranked it is for Jackie because she was very close with her family, and she wanted to come back to the island. Her aunt had prophesied that we were moving back to the island, so I sort of, all right, I'll give it to you. And it was probably one of the greatest turning points of my life that I ended up moving back to Long Island. And, of course, as I said, God knew how much I could take. Fast forward about 18 years, and my middle child, my oldest son, became really, really sick, slowly and steadily. And finally, on a Wednesday, he was admitted to a children's hospital. It was called Schneider's Children's Hospital. Then now it's Cohen's. And they did a whole bunch of tests on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Finally, Friday afternoon, the chairman of the Department of Rheumatology, who was taking care of him, pulls me aside and says, we still have a couple more tests, but it looks like he's got a really, really serious disease. There's no known cure, and over the next couple of weeks, his lungs are going to fill up with blood. We'll intubate him, make him comfortable, and you can be at his bedside when he dies. So have a good weekend. See you Monday. Anyway, so that was multiple steps backwards. Maybe a little collapse to the ground. But thank God, you know the definition of a miracle, Romans 8, is God raises the dead and he gives life into, and calls into being that which does not exist. And that's what he did for my son. He ended up having a very serious disease, but over about a year, he slowly got better, and I slowly resumed my walk. And then finally, of course, many of you know that Jackie, my wife, passed away about 8 months ago. And that's been very difficult. The greatest comfort I have is just knowing she's rejoicing in glory forever with him, and we will be back together again. And God's doing, amen. Amen. But boy, talk about not putting one foot in front of the other, right? But wait a minute, Pastor Bob. If you don't feel close to the Lord, who moved? Come on, right? I don't want to go into great detail, but that's really the theme, if you think about it, of the book of Job. Job, we're told, was, by God, the most righteous man on the face of the earth. In the narrative, it says that he was the richest man in the East. And in the course of a very short time, he lost everything. One day, I lost my wife. He lost 10 out of 10 of his children in one building collapsing. Same time, he lost every bit of his wealth. And then shortly later, he lost his health. And then a few weeks or months later, he's sitting in dust and ashes, wearing sackcloth. He's got pieces of broken pottery, and he's scraping boils open from his arms and his legs and his trunk because he's just in so much pain. This is in the story. He stinks. Nobody wants, his wife doesn't want to go near him. His breath smells. His body smells. His ribs are sticking out. And his friends come, and you know what they say to him? If you don't feel close to God, Job, who moved? They didn't put it that way, but they basically said it's because you're sinning, when we know, of course, that he wasn't. Another story for another day. In any case, what I want to look at now is why do we come to that place of wondering, God, where are you? How come I don't feel as close to you as I used to? And so what I want to look at is on the handout, three reasons, and I don't say these are the absolute be-all and end-all, but I want to talk about the fact that doubts have many causes, that they're part of our journey of faith, and that they can actually draw us a lot closer to God. Okay, so doubts have many causes. I'll tell you, I am sure that there are people, I know there are people who leave the church, not because God isn't good, but because they have doubts, and they don't feel safe, they don't feel comfortable talking about it to other Christians. Okay? Listen, there are many, many causes of doubts. I just want to look briefly at three of them now. The first is questions that I can't answer. You read the Bible, it seems to say this over here, it says that over there. You don't understand, and you don't get it. And the reason is simple. The Bible is a difficult book. But don't give up. You've got to realize that it is a difficult book. Ask questions. Get into a Bible study. And let me tell you something else. You know, hundreds of years ago, very, very, very few people could even own a Bible. It was before the printing press, which was the 1400s, which didn't make it super available. But before that, a Bible was literally handwritten by a scribe. And even if you could afford it, even fewer people could even read to begin with. Today, let me just tell you this. Every one of us at least has access to a computer. Did you ever hear of Google? You can put your questions in, and Google's got an answer before you finish typing it. Every one of us has ability to get those questions answered, okay? So that's the first thing, questions you can't answer, but Google can. The second is situations that seem unfair. And let me tell you, I'm a real pro at this one. I have preached this message or this idea many, many times, okay? Because the bottom line here is that life isn't fair. Right? It isn't, you know, suck it up, get used to it. This is earth, it's not heaven. The world is fallen. Bad things happen to good people. Good things happen to bad people. People, innocent people, children die. So I can be very objective when I say that. Until life happens. Or, as Mike Tyson once said, everyone's got a plan, right? Till they get punched in the mouth, right? I didn't say that, he did. Right? And then it's not so easy to be objective, because once again, life just isn't fair. And then the third reason is hurts that you can't resolve. Terrible things happen, maybe in the church, maybe a church leader, somebody respected, fell, or maybe he or she caused other people in the church to fall. Who knows what it might be? Or maybe you thought the church was supposed to be a safe place, and you learn the hard way that it always isn't. And I'll give you one more big one. Christians who lack grace. We're the ones who go around saying, if you don't feel close to God, who moved? Right, a bumper sticker Christianity, you know that one, right? God said it, I believe it, and that settles it. Listen, the world is rarely black and white, okay? Everybody has hurts. Everyone has pains. Life is complicated, and we all have situations that we've got to work through, but here is what I want to point out here. You really need flexibility in your own life and when you're talking to other people. You know, if you are flexible, the stresses come and the branches can bend. People can get over it. But if you're not flexible, the stress comes and this is supposed to snap. I gotta tell you, this is weird, this is true. I planned that wonderful demonstration that backfired. It did crack a little bit. But here's this is true now. About a week ago, I went out to this tree. It's called a witch's broom. I guess I shouldn't be saying that in church. But it's it's got all these fine little branches. And I took off a piece, like about this size, and I went in the house and crack, crack, crack. I mean, it just fell apart in my hand. I was actually going to say, look at that. It fell into like six pieces. Well, in the last week, all of a sudden, there's like, and I didn't realize it till right now, there's buds on this witch's broom, and the tree is coming back to life, and now it's flexible. So I guess maybe there's a message in there someday. I don't know. Anyway, it was supposed to crack. When you're not flexible, that's what happened. Okay, so the point is that when people have questions, if we don't feel like we can bend, sometimes they feel that their only option is to walk away from God. Okay, so that's a lot of the reasons that people doubt. What I want to do now for the rest of these last 2 points and for the rest of the message is talk about a person who's been very maligned in the Bible, I believe. A good person to speak about in the context of doubts, Doubting Thomas, and what we learn from him. And what we do find from Thomas is that when we handle our doubts properly, and he had doubts, it can actually draw us closer to God and increase our faith, because faith is a journey. It's not a destination. It's putting one foot in front of the other. And there's no such thing as faith without doubts. Doubts actually should cause and do cause our faith to grow. And that's what we see in Thomas. So let's start with the first of 2 points about Thomas now, and that doubts are part of our journey of faith. And what I'm about to read is now during those 40 days that Jesus walked the earth between his resurrection and the ascension to heaven. And we read, Thomas, one of the 12, who was called Didymus. I got to pause here for a moment. So Thomas's name prior to being called Doubting Thomas was Thomas Didymus. But you might not be aware that he actually had a nickname before he was called Doubting Thomas. Okay? You ready? Here it comes. Thomas Didymus was T. Diddy. I mean, is that like the best grandpa joke ever? Come on. Okay. So Thomas, who was called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples were saying to him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the imprint of the nails, and put my finger into the place of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. What we just read now is that the disciples who did believe, believed because they saw Jesus. Thomas didn't see Jesus, and he didn't believe. But if you think about it, I think Thomas was probably more of a realist. I had this tremendous aha moment just this past week or so. I was listening to a testimony of a missionary to Russia. And I only caught the last half or so. The gist that I got is that she must have lived in a Russian community here in the U.S. before going to Russia. Anybody here from Russia? Okay, good. And you know that disclaimer, the opinions discussed, presented in this message are not necessarily that of the the church, okay? Anyway, this is her words now. Prior to going to Russia, she said that she found Russian people to be incredibly obnoxious, demanding, and pushy. And then she went to Russia. I'm not going to ask anybody if you've been hanging around Russian people, okay? But point is, she went to Russia, and you know what she found? If you want to feed your children, if you want bread, you've got to be pushy and obnoxious and demanding. Do you want medicine? Do you want medical care for your family? That's what it takes, okay? My point here is that I think that Thomas was probably like that. He'd seen stuff. He had heartaches. He had problems and disappointments. And he had real honest questions. Didn't make him a bad person. It simply made him human. Oswald Chambers, a very famous Christian author, writes, doubt isn't always a sign that a person is wrong. It might just be a sign that they're thinking. I'll tell you, looking over the life of Thomas, I would put his faith towards the top of the 12. We know from Matthew 28, that's where Jesus got the disciples together before he ascended. They all saw him, and some doubted. Okay, they saw Jesus, and they doubted. But you know, by that point in time, Thomas realized that faith doesn't always come from sight. I mean, that's one of the lessons that he learned. Faith is way more than sight. So let me tell you two stories from Thomas's experience after he first became Doubting Thomas and then Jesus met him. In John 11, we read the story of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead. And it started, Jesus messengers were sent to Jesus that his friend Lazarus is really sick. Jesus waited a while and knew that he was going to die. And then he turned to the disciples and said, okay, we've got to go to Judea. Now, if you read the earlier part in John 10, it turns out that the Pharisees, the religious leaders in Judea, which is where Jerusalem was or is, were plotting to kill him. They wanted him gone. And so the disciples get together, Lord, you can't go to Judea. But you know what Thomas said? Let's go and die with him. I mean, his knowledge was a little bit incomplete, but he certainly was all in. And then in John chapter 14, we have the story of where Jesus says to the disciples, I must go and prepare a way for you so that where I am, you may be also, and you know the way. And Thomas was like, whoa, Lord, stop it. No, we don't know the way. God, tell us the way. Okay, he had sincere questions. Okay, so we learn from Thomas that doubts are part of our faith journey. He grew through his doubts, realizing that faith and sight aren't necessarily the same. And then the last point I want to make is that doubts can actually draw us closer to God. And I want to read the very next verses. In other words, doubting Thomas' scripture was John 20, 24 and 25. And now we're going to look at 26, 7, and 8 in John chapter 20. It says, after 8 days, his disciples were again inside. So Thomas said, I'm not going to believe until it happens. And Thomas with them. Jesus came, the doors having been shut, and stood in their midst and said, peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, reach here with your finger and see my hands. And reach here your hand and put it into my side and do not be unbelieving, but believing. Thomas, don't doubt. Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. So what did Jesus do? What does he do for us? How does he respond to Thomas? He comes to us and he went to Thomas and he gave him exactly what he needed. And Thomas went from doubting to shouting, right? Point being again that doubt is an important part of our faith journey. When you doubt, go to him. Tell him you don't understand. Ask questions. Complain. He can handle it. That's what Thomas did. And after Matthew 28, where Jesus commissioned the disciples to go into all the world, that's what he did. He went to India, and he basically started the entire church in India, and until recently, with people being much more mobile, until World War II-ish or so, pretty much every Christian in India could trace their spiritual heritage back to Thomas. And then, at the end of his life, he chose to be martyred for the Lord rather than renouncing his faith. Because faith is a journey, not a destination. The musicians want to come on up. And in that journey, we have plenty of ups and downs, part of which are from doubts. Let me tell you something. If you haven't had that yet, you will, I guarantee it. And I can also guarantee you that the devil's going to try to use those doubts to draw you away from God. He's going to whisper in your ear things like, you're not a Christian. Even if you were, Christianity isn't real. God doesn't love you. He doesn't care about you. He's not interested in you. And when you die, you become worm food. Listen, the devil is a liar, and he's the father of all lies. He's got way more lies than I could ever come up with. But the answer to all the lies and the doubts and the fears is not to crawl into a little ball. The answer is to put one foot in front of the others. Look to Jesus. Remember everything that he's done. Tell him what you're going through. I imagine just about all of us know the 23rd Psalm, very famous Psalm of David, in verse 4, right? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I think some of us are going through the valley of the shadow of doubt. And the way out of the valley, I've said it multiple times today, put one foot in front of the other. That's what our journey of faith is all about. You don't stay in the valley. You ask questions, and you remember that whatever happens, God is trustworthy. And that we don't need perfect, infallible faith. We've just got to put that one foot in front of the other. We've all got doubts. Don't let them stop you. You have to remember there are plenty of causes. I barely touched it. That only makes you human when you experience them. Doubts are part of our journey of faith, and they can actually draw us closer to God. So let me just encourage you this week. If and when you wonder and question, you have doubts, remember that. They don't make you bad, they make you human. And turn to God. And you know what? It's going to draw you closer to Him, and it's going to make your faith that much stronger. Amen. Let's stand. We'll close with prayer, and then the musicians are going to send us home on Palm Sunday, all right? Father, we thank you for bringing us together today. We thank you for this day that you entered into Jerusalem, oh God, in the beginning of Holy Week, the week of awe. And Lord, it will terminate with you being raised from the dead. We thank you, and we bless you, and we give you all the glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God.
should be a celebration for letting Jesus into our lives. Amen.